Hello everyone. We will start this session again. In this session, we will discuss about a knockout, which is another JavaScript library. Most of the time, we people use this knockout JavaScript library nowadays. Before we start this, if you people have any questions, query in your machine room, then you people can ask me quickly. We have a shortage of time now. If you have a questions, please you can raise your questions. If anyone have a questions, please ask your questions, and then we will move next. So no other questions? So I will start the next session about knockout. So knockout is another JavaScript library which we used, and we also call it KO. It is basically a one another library which is a lightweight, and we can use this library with any browsers. And again, this library is also based on MVC model, but over here I will not use a C, I will say MV and VM. So meaning to say is, in earlier in AngularJS I was using MVC, and here I will use a MVVM. Okay, so model is same as earlier, view is same as earlier, and over there I was using a controller. No, here I'm using a view model. Okay, the difference is nothing, same. In view model I have a maybe my variables and my functions. Okay, in my model I have my variables and I have a view. Okay, that is my user interface. View model I will use to maybe communicate with my model and view. So this is an architecture of knockout. Now I have a model, as I said, I have a view and I have a view model. A model refers to the application's data, and view is your user interface. And view model I use to connect model and view. Secondly, model it stores the data entered by the user through UI elements, and view it provides a structure of UI to the user, and the view model hold both data and the function. It means sometimes if I want to use view model together and I want to add a data or a function in my view model, I can do that. So moving next now, again in my local JavaScript library, again we have two way winding. First winding is one way winding and second is a two way. Different the syntax is different, and working and the functionality is almost same. The only the syntax which we use in knockout is not same as the Angular. Now when I use a knockout in one way data binding, I have the a procedure to use. So first I will do what same as earlier I was using in AngularJS. At the top of my page I was adding my JavaScript library or my AngularJS library file reference. The same thing I will do over here. Then I will get a view model, and then when I will finish my view model, after that I need to activate the knockout so that it will do his functionality. If you remember, I was using a ng app over here so that my web page can start his functionality using AngularJS. Now here I will use a activate knockout. So whenever I will activate knockout, it will start his functionality. For example, if say I create a web page and I add a library, I create a model view and I forgot to activate the knockout, I will not get the result. Okay, this is the way we work in a knockout. Please look at the screen here again. In the beginning, I am trying to add the knockout library file, and again I have two options. Either I can download in my own computer or I can use a CDN for that. So in the displayed example, you can see over here I'm trying to add the source file that is on my local machine. Then I am trying to create a view model, and you can see if I'm trying to say that I am saying where my view model equal, and then I'm trying to declare a variable person name and the person is, and I'm assigning the value. Now here it is my view model, and whenever I will try to access them in my view, I will write something like this. You can see again here I need to use the DataBind property, sorry, attribute here. So I will say span DataBind. The question which comes here is why I need to use a DataBind over here, because I want to display the data which is in my knockout. Okay, and then I will say text person name. This is the name of my variable. Okay, similarly I will say DataBind and person age. Now to activate my knockout, I'm writing ko knockout dot apply binding. Okay, and then inside that I'm writing the name of my view model. Why I am doing this? The answer is this one. In my over here, I'm using a data bind. Okay, this data bind I'm using, because this data bind is not a part of the HTML, and when I will try to run this, okay, maybe my browser will not find this. So I need to do what? I need to write this line ko dot apply binding, so that the data which is inside my model, I can get it over here in my view. Okay, so remember one thing, I need to add the data bind here attribute to bind the data, like I was doing in my AngularJS. Okay, so now I will give one example here how we can use that. Tell them that to remove my picture. Okay, so I will give one small demo how I use a knockout, and the example is of one way winding. So in the beginning, when I'm trying to add my library file here, I also need to add the jQuery library file. So I'm writing these two library file at the top, and then I'm writing something about my CSS. Here you can see I'm trying to create one view model, and in that I am trying to say that I have a variable that view my view model okay, which will work as an object, and inside that I am using one a variable whose name is person name, and this is the initial value, and then I try to use one another variable, that is a person age. Now I want to display these two values, these two variables values in my view over here, so I need to use a data bind, as I said. And when I will say data bind, so I want to display what? I want to display a text. So I am saying a person name. So this is a person name, a variable name over here. And when I add these two over here, after that I need to activate my knockout. So I will say ko.apply binding my view model. And if I will run this program, it will just give me the a message. My name is and my age is. So this is just one example, simple example, how can I do a one way binding. In one way binding, my model is binded with or attached with my view. Okay, just a simple example over here. So I'm moving next now, and this is just one example which I display to you now. And then is how to implement a two-way data binding in my knockout. To implement a two-way data binding in knockout, I have two options. I can do a data two-way data binding by using a observable object. If, for example, if I have only the example which I used earlier like that, and if I have a collections, okay, so in that case I will use a observable arrays. Two options I have: observable object and observable arrays. So the procedure to do a two-way data binding is same as in one-way binding. I at the top of my web page, I need to add the library files. I need to create a view model, and then I will create a view, and then at the end I will activate my knockout. And another thing which I need to do is over here, that I need to use either a observable object or a observable arrays. Now here, one of the key benefits of using knockout is that it updates user interface automatically when the view model changes. As I explained in AngularJS, same thing happened here now. This feature is also available in a knockout. It means whenever I made any changes in my model, it will reflect in my view. Or if I made any change in my view, it will update in my model. So how to do that? You can find on the screen here. I was earlier in my earlier example, when I was using a simple example of my knockout, and I was trying to create an object. Over here you can see I was writing where my view model equal, and I was giving the name of the variable, and then I was giving the value. But in this case now, what I am adding new over here is I am adding a observable over here. See, for this you need to declare your model property as a observable. How to do that? What I will do is I will use my variable name, then I need to use KO, that is abbreviation for knockout. So knockout dot observable, this is basically a function. Okay, remember this, this is basically a function. Okay, so I will say ko dot observable, and inside this I will write the value. So this variable will get a value now. If I want to give the value, you can see if I want to give a new value, I will say my view model dot person name is same as earlier we did in AngularJS. I will give the example over here now again for this this one, two-way data binding. So look at the example here. Any changes which I will do, you can find over here whatever I am trying to change in my view, okay, that is being updated in my model. So this is example of a two-way binding and how this is happening. I'm going to explain here again. Almost same, only a small difference. At the top, again, I need to add the library files. So every time I need to do that, then over here, you can see at this place, I'm trying to make my view model and I'm trying to make a function in that I have two parameters. First and last, and then this dot first name is same as the this represent to the current object, in same as in we use in another programming language. So this refer to the current object. So I said this dot first name equal to ko dot observable, and you can find over here at this place I am giving the name of the parameter which I am passing in my function at this place. Similarly, same, you can see over here ko dot observable is last. So what I did is I create a view model, and inside the function I pass two parameters. I use two variables, first name and last name. I want to declare them observable, so I am using this function observable, and inside this I pass the parameters, and these two parameters are given over here. Now I am using one another variable, and I am saying this full name variable equal to, now what I am trying to do here is I am trying to compute that. So I am saying ko dot computed, okay, and when I am saying ko dot computed, so in this function what I am trying to do is I said return what, first name and last name. So I am saying this dot first name plus this dot last name, okay, and I try to just, this is my function, and after that when I want to activate my knockout, what I did is I call my view model here. I said ko dot apply binding, and I give the name view model, and these are the parameters value, and over here you can find this place. When I'm saying hello span data bind text equal to full name, this is the name which is given over here. Okay, so this is how my knockout works in my this knock view model works in my knockout JavaScript library. Two-way binding, anything I will change in model, it will reflect in my view. Any change in my view, it will update in my model. After that, maybe I want to use collections, arrays. So at that time, what I will do is I will not use a observable object. Instead of using that, I will use a observable array. Now, at what time I will use this? As I said just now, when it comes that I have to store more than one value in one maybe object, I will use a observable array. You can find this example. I'm trying to declare my observable array equal to ko dot observable array, and inside that I am giving more than one value. It means I am trying to make one array, okay, and that is declared as a observable. Now how to access the values? To access these values, you can see again I will write the my object name, and then I need to use the index. So over here my observable array, and then I am giving the index value. So it will help me to get the value which is given in the zero index. When I use an observable array, I have some functions which I can use here. I have a function whose name is push. Push is something to add something. I have a pop. So you can see over here, it removes the last value from an array. I have a shift. It removes the first value from an array and return it. And then I have a reverse. I have a sort, and I have a remove all. It meaning to say is just to make any manipulation in my collection, I can use all these functions. Are simple functions which I can do. And the coming example on knockout is based on collections, and I will try to use all these functions in my program. What I am trying to do is I am trying to make one a text box, and over here I have a button, and I want that whenever I add the item over here, a text, when I add over here, it get activated, and once I add the item inside my this list, it will display over here. Secondly, I want to select by default one item whose name is a coffee. I have a another option to perform here, that is maybe I can remove the items from my list. I can sort the values. You can see I can sort the values. So just give me a moment. So look at the example. This is example. It may be just a slow synchronization. Just have a look now. I have one web page, and in this web page I have a one list, and I want to add the list item inside that, and I have one text box in which I will write the items, and I will add the items. Any items you want to add over here, you can just write this and just say add. It will come to my list item. And whenever I want to perform actions like I want to remove, sort or reverse, you can see I have option to reverse the items, I have option to sort the items, and I have option to remove the item from the list. So I am using the functions which just now I explained to you. Let's have a look how this program is working. So this is the part which I don't want to explain again, okay, and I'll come to my script part here, okay. Before that, let's have a look over here in my HTML part. What I'm trying to do, I said div class equal to my class, and I use a form, and with my form I use a data bind, and I said when I will click the submit, it will use a add item. So add item is a function over here. Okay, so here is add item at this list. Inside this, I have one input type text, okay, and again I am saying data bind. I want to bind what? I want to bind value. I have two options, either text, either value, okay. So I am saying I want to bind a value, and I am saying bind what? I want to bind an item to add, okay. Over here I have item to add, okay. So then value update, when I want to update the value, it meaning to say is at what time value will update. The value will update when I will press the key, okay, after key down. So over here I use a submit and I call the function, okay, item to add. Another thing I'm over here I'm writing button type submit data bind equal to enable, then I'm saying item add to length. Why I'm writing over here, for example, I want that if someone writes something over here, then only this button get enabled, okay. So because when I will say length, so it will give me the length of that, okay. If I will not write anything, it does not have any value, so means have no length. So now then after, what I will do is I will try to use another option. This is choose your options, okay. This is choose your option, and I have a select tag here, and in this select tag I am saying I want to, sorry, I want to bind the values inside my this list box. So I'm writing here first thing multiple equal to, means I can select the multiple items like this, you can see on my screen with the help of my mouse or with the help of my keyboard I can choose something like this. So I am writing here multiple select, and then I'm writing data bind options. Now when I'm saying options, after that I'm using all items. Somewhere here I defined all items, okay. So all items are coming over here. Then another option is selected options, meaning to say is sometimes maybe I want to bind the values only a selected items, okay. For that it is written over here, not add all items, add only selected items. Then I have buttons, three buttons I use, remove, sort and reverse, and for them I call the functions. Now look at the script part here. At the beginning what I am trying to do is I am saying variable better list model, means what is the name of my view model? Name of my view model is better list model, this one. Then I am trying to make function over here. I define one variable and initially it has no value. Then I try to create one collection array, you can say. So I'm trying to make a collection and I try to add the items inside that. You can see the difference is very clear. One time I use observable object and second time I use a observable array. Then after I'm trying to say is this dot selected items. This dot selected items meaning to say is now what? I want to select the, I want to do what? I want to initially show the selected item is what? Coffee. So over here this dot selected items equal to ko dot observable array, and this is the key which I choose, I mean the index which I choose or the value I can choose to select. Remember one thing, this thing we also do in our HTML part. When we use a select tag, and by default we select one thing, okay, for that we just write a selected. So same thing is over here. I want to make one list item, and I want to add the item inside that, and then I want to by default select one item, and for that I'm using this line. Then I have a coding to add items inside my list. So for that I'm using a variable here, add item, and what is the value? For that I'm creating a function, and I'm saying if this dot item to add not equal to null, and this dot all items dot index of this dot index of, why I'm using index of, because I want to know items must be index total items. You can see items to add, this is one function which I am going to use, items to add. So okay, so this is one variable name, items to add, I am writing over here, and it must be less than 0. So this dot all item dot push, and it meaning to say is I want to add items inside the array list, and whenever I write something over here, so the item will come over here. And then I again make this item to add empty. Similarly, I am using one function to remove selected items. When I select the items over here, and I will say remove, so it will help me to remove the items from the list. So for that I am writing this code, this dot all items dot remove all, see, and this dot selected items. If you are aware with a simple array function, okay, so you can see over here I have a function remove all. Just now I explained function remove all, so it will help me to remove the items from my list. And then I have one another function which is to sort the values. I am writing this dot items dot sort. I have another function which is to reverse the items, so this dot all items dot reverse. Okay, so this is all about knockout. We are not covering each and every thing of knockout and Angular JS in this course. We are just giving an overview how we can use a Angular JS and a knockout. I have made some another activities and exercises based on knockout. I also made one to-do list using a knockout that is available in your exercise. So whenever you have a time, just try to open that. Explanation is given in the hint, so you can find it from there. Yes, please. If you have some questions, some doubts related to knockout, we can discuss, and then I have to start lesson number 6 because we are running short of time. If you have a questions, please you can ask your questions. I have made an activity for this using a knockout that I will show you here. This is one example which I have made for my knockout application. You can find on this computer over here. This is just example. We create a shopping cart. I will try to add some items. For example, if I change this, okay, it will change. If I want to add item, I can choose item from here, okay. If I want to remove item, I can also remove item from here. This is one simple example which I create using a knockout, and now this is how we people nowadays works on a different website, on maybe on the shopping websites. Yes, please. Do you have any questions regarding a knockout? Then we can discuss. Otherwise, I will start a new session. How many people are here? Anyone have a doubt? Then if you have a doubt, then you can ask, then we can clear the doubts, and then we can move forward. The example which just now I displayed to you, this example is using a knockout, and the explanation is given in my LG, okay. And another exercise which I created on a knockout is my to-do list, and the explanation is also given in that hint guide, okay. So you can just have a look for that, and if you have a problem, then please come back to me. Yes, please. Yeah, I will end of the day I will share each and every demo with you. That is not a problem. Any other person have any question, any doubt? I think it's not very hard. The only difference over here is in my knockout I am using a observable, okay, for two-way winding, and if I am using a collection, then I have to use a observable array. Rest, for two-way winding over there I was using a ng model, and here I have to say what? Here in this case I need to say that I will use a observable for two-way winding. Over there when I in Angular when I want to make a one-way winding, I was using a ng bind, and here in this case when I want to use a one-way winding, I will not use anything. I will just declare my view model, and I will attach my view model with my view. This is the only difference we have in AngularJS and a knockout. I request everyone, please clear your doubts. If you have any doubts in knockout or AngularJS, if you have any doubt in your previous session, then please ask, okay. Otherwise, start a next topic. I hope you people are sitting on the chairs. No response. Okay. Then I will start next topic. In the next topic, I will talk something about jQuery. Okay. If you remember lesson number two, in the lesson number two, I explained how we can implement a style on my HTML elements using a CSS. So this lesson is in the beginning, I will explain you how to manipulate and traverse HTML DOM using a jQuery. The first topic is how to manipulate HTML elements using a jQuery. For example, in my CSS, I have a property. I have one element selector like first, a first child. Then I have a last. Then a parent. Same thing I want to perform here in my jQuery. Okay. It meaning to say is what I will do is I will try to implement styles on my HTML elements using a jQuery, and what I will do is inside the jQuery code I will try to embed a CSS code. Okay, this is this session about this session is about manipulating an HTML elements. Okay, see here, if you remember. In the lesson number second, I explained is how to manipulate HTML element using a CSS. So now this topic is how to manipulate HTML element using a jQuery. And some example of jQuery selectors are I have a contains, odd, even, first, child. All these I explained in a second chapter. But at that time, I was trying to use it with a CSS. I was directly applying a CSS to these elements, but now I will do with the help of a jQuery. So in the beginning I have one selector. It is a contains. Okay, why I use this? It select elements containing the specified string. Okay, let's try to understand with example over here. Just give me a second. So what I will do is I will try to use all these element sectors one by one, and so that you can easily understand, and later whenever you will create your web, so you can club them and then you can use that. Okay, so the first example is about contains selectors. And how it is working? First, let me show the demo here. Just have a look to my web page. I'm saying welcome to my home page, and inside that one message is I'm giving where is your home, and I live in New Delhi. Do you have a best friend? Yes, my best friend is Mitty, and what is your family name? So what I'm trying to do is, from these string, I am trying to find out the string which is is. Okay, so wherever in my this program, my program found a is, so it will give me the it will apply the style whichever I am applying in my jQuery code. So this is my HTML part. you can find over here, nothing is new, just h1 tag, p tag, and just I'm writing a text, where is your home, I live in Delhi, blah blah blah, okay. And then I am coming to my script tag over here, and I think this I no need to explain, but still if you don't know, yeah, don't forgot, then I will explain this. In my jQuery I always use this document.ready, so that I want that my web page will not perform any action until my web page will not load fully in my computer memory. So it means I want that first my web page will load in computer memory, then any action, whatever action I want to do, I will perform that time, okay. So normally every time I will write this. So what I am trying to do is, in this program I am saying p contains is. Now p here means what? I am talking about a p is the name of the element, okay. So I am saying p contains is. Now I will look here, p, this p where is. So I have a is in this paragraph, so it means this style will apply to this one. Then I live in Delhi, in this I don't have is. Then do you have a best friend? There is no is. Then yes, my best friend is Mickey, so here I have is. And what is your family name? So here again I have is. Now look at the coding over here. I said the paragraph contain is over here is CSS. It meaning to say is what? Whenever I use a contain, and after that what I did is I try to use a dot CSS, okay. And inside that what I did is over here I try to find I try to write the CSS properties, okay. So it meaning to say is, first this contain will do what? This contain will try to find out the string, okay. When it match, so what I did is it will return true, and then I said dot CSS. It meaning to say is, the same time I want to apply the CSS style, and I am writing over here the first property. You can see again it's just like an array. So when you want to write something like an array, so you need to add here in a braces. I need to use curly braces over here. So over here the first property I'm saying background color, and then the value is orange. Then you can see over here I'm using a colon, and then I have another property, and for that I use a comma. So background color is orange, and the text color is green. And when I run this program, you can see the output is coming over here. You can see on your screens, background is orange and the color is green, okay. The simple example how I can use a contains. Moving next, I have another element whose name is even and odd. Meaning to say is, when I use even, it will select the even element, and then if I select the odd, maybe it will select the odd element. Meaning to say is, let's say for example, if I am using a table, and inside that table I have the rows, and when I say the first row, that first row is an even row, and the second, okay, odd, sorry, first, like that. So first is odd and then is even. In here, this case you can see I'm writing tr dot odd and tr dot even. So when I will run this program here, so this color, it means the first row is even color, even, okay, 1 2 3, like this. So first row is even and second row is odd here. So second row it has a yellow color and the first row has a cyan color. So what is the name of the selector? Selector name is odd and even, okay. So where I am using these, I am using with a tr tag. So it will try to find out tr tag in my program at this place. Okay. You can find over here odd. It selects each element with an odd index numbers such as 1, 3 and 5, and the index number starts with a 0. Okay, then I have another option, that is even. When I use a even, it selects each element with an even index like 0 and 2 and a 4. Then I have another selector, that is a first child. Okay, it select all elements that are the first child of their parents. Remember, first child of their parents, it meaning to say is, if I am saying the first parent element name is div, and inside that div I have a element whose name is p, immediately after that div. So I will say the first child, okay. And I also want that if that p tag repeat again in the same div, it will not apply, I mean that style will not apply to that one, it will only apply to the first one, first child only. And similarly, I have an option for the last child, it will apply the style to the last child only. Let's have a look with example over here. I hope you will understand, this is very easy to understand. This is the output which I am getting over here now. And what is the coding? Now you can see the coding part over here. See at this place. Try to understand over here. The first element is body, okay, and then I have a p tag, it means after body I have a p tag, and inside this scripting what I'm writing is, I'm saying p first child. Okay, if p is a first child, then it will apply the style. Now you can see this p is the first child of the body tag. So over here you can see the color applied, and after that over here I try to use one div tag, and inside this div I use a three paragraphs, and what I said is, I said inside div p is the first element. Okay, so you can look at the output. In the output, the first paragraph in div, it gets the color. Okay, second paragraph did not get the color, and the last paragraph did not get the color. Though last paragraph is getting a color because I also have written some coding for the last child. But first I will explain the first child only. Now you can find at this place, I close my div, and this is a p tag, again a p tag. Where it is coming, this is coming inside the body. So the color, this design applied to this first tag, but it is not applied in the second option. Then what I try to do is, again I try to create another container, div container, and you just try to understand this thing. This time after div, span is the immediate child. After that, after div, I have a span. I don't have a p tag. Now you can see, but inside this here, I have used a p tag 3 times. But this inside this over here, inside this div, you will find that this style is not applied. The reason is what? The reason is that in this div, p is not the first child, because span is the first child. Okay, so the color is not applied over here, and then I am using again p tag over here, and you can see this p tag got a color last paragraph in a body. Why? Because over here I'm writing p last child, and this paragraph, it was coming first time in the body tag, this place it was coming second time, and coming here third time, so it will apply the style. Similarly here in this div over here, I use a p and it is the last style of this div, so the style applied. And then I have a last paragraph in a div over here, so style applied. So what I'm using is a first child and a last child, but remember, first child of the parent element. Okay, so I have explained the okay, I haven't explained the first and last. I also have option of first and last. So first, I will explain the first. It selects only the first matched elements which occurs first irrespective of its parent's elements in the whole document. It meaning to say is something which comes first time in his parent element, and same thing comes to your last, which comes at the last of his parent element. I'm not talking about the child, I'm just talking about the first and last. So here you can see I am using the first and last. A simple example, this is a body tag, okay, and this is a parent for my this p tag, and what I am trying to say here is I am saying that p first time, I want to look a p tag which is coming first time in my parent tag, which is body, and then I have a p at the end. Okay, and if I try to run this, it will apply the style on my first and the last. Then I have another example over here regarding how to use attribute names, like in the in lesson 2, chapter 2, I explained that how I can use attributes to manipulate the HTML elements. So same thing is over here. At that time I also explained how I can use HTML elements name to manipulate the HTML elements. So both examples I will give to you now. Before that I will show you on my slides here. Apart from jQuery selectors, we can use attribute values and we can use attribute elements name. The syntax is same as earlier we use in CSS, and you can find over here at this place I will use the tag name. For example, let's say over here is a body tag, display stack name is a body, and maybe the attribute name is maybe a background, okay, or maybe a BG color, or maybe a color like that. So over here I will write the attribute name, and this place is the value. I have an example over here. You can just try to understand. I said div name of students means it will write the name of the students. I have a UL, and UL has an attribute class, and value is greater 90. Okay. Then again UL class lesser 90. Now in my jQuery, what I am writing over here, I said to highlight the name of those students who have scored more than 90 in yellow color. What I am trying to do, I said variable res. It meaning to say is, what I am trying to do over here, I am just trying to access the attribute. What is the name? Greater 90. And I will store this value into a this variable res. So I am saying variable res equal to UL is element name and class attribute, and the value is what? Greater 90. And what style I want to apply? RESCS background color is yellow. So in my this example, you can see people who got more than 90, the colors of their background becomes yellow. Similarly, I have another option over here. I can use elements. Okay, elements name, for example h1, input, select, button, all these element names I can use to manipulate the HTML elements. One example I will give over here, look at this example. I have a one tag span and some font I set over here, post your feedback. I have a form, ID is form1, and then I create a table, and inside that table I set the width, okay, and TD first name, then I have an input box, okay, and then last name I have an input box. I will give you the real demo of this also. Then another, I have a text area, and I have a submit button, okay, and for that this I am writing a jQuery over here. I'm saying here hash submit button. Now you can see over here input ID submit button. So at this place I'm trying to access hash submit button dot click. It means whenever I will click on that button, what it will do, it will say var input equal to, now I am writing over here inputs equal to, I said, you can see over here I am writing the name of the element. It means it will take input from all the input elements. Now then I am giving a message alert box thanks and input. You can see I am using over index over there. Why I am writing index? Because it may be there are more than input control in my web page. Now let's have a look of example of these two, how to use attributes and how to use elements. This was an example. I will write something. And I will click on my submit button, and then it will display a message alert box thanks for your feedback. So what I am trying to do in this example, you can see I am trying to access element name, okay. Another example which I explained just to you, that is for attribute, you can find over here. I was trying to access UL element, and this UL element has one attribute named class, and that class has a value greater 90. Now when I try to run these programs, see, when I try to run this, you can see whoever get more than 90, it displayed in a background is yellow color. So this example is just how to use attributes to manipulate HTML elements. This chapter, basically initial part of this chapter, is the same as which we learned in a lesson number 2, but the only difference is at that time there I was using a CSS to manipulate the HTML elements, and here I'm using a jQuery to manipulate the HTML elements. Now the question is, why I am using a jQuery to manipulate HTML elements? Why not using the CSS? Yes, please give an answer, Puneet. Puneet. Yes, Puneet. Just tell me one thing. This thing I was doing in lesson number 2. I was manipulating my HTML elements using CSS in lesson 2, and now I am manipulating in this lesson using a jQuery. What is the reason behind that?
Sir, jQuery is a JavaScript library basically, and it is used to manipulate the CSS properties at runtime instead of state. Sir, can you hear me right now? Am I audible? Hello?
I cannot hear. Hello? Yeah.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. jQuery is a JavaScript library. It is backed by the JavaScript, and the purpose of using jQuery is to you can say change the properties at runtime instead of compile time. Change the properties at runtime totally. Okay,
so I am changing this only because I am doing this because I want to change the my HTML element at the runtime. Okay, this is the only purpose I am doing that.
Yes,
otherwise I can do it on my static portion in my CSS.
Statically also.
Okay.
Yes,
so I think it's easy. Any other person who has a question?
No, sir. Not yet.
Okay, then I will start next. This example I already finished. So in this session, I just explained how we use HTML elements, and I want to manipulate them using the jQuery. I use different options. I use element name, I use attribute name, and I use some jQuery selectors to manipulate my HTML elements. Okay, this session was very short session, and next I have another option, that is a traversing HTML DOM using a jQuery. Just try to understand why I use traversing the DOM. Okay, do you have any idea why I use this? Anyone have idea? One thing I want to explain here. Just try to understand my meaning over here. just think that I am trying to make one HTML page, okay, just a simple HTML page, and I am writing my HTML page something like this. I have HTML, I have a head, title, body, table, and some other element inside my HTML page. Okay, now right now my page is very small and I can easily navigate, you know, from here to there. But sometimes it happens that when my web page is very big and I have so many elements and I want to move from one place to another place, and at that time it is hard to navigate fast. So what my computer does here is, whenever I create HTML document, he changes that into one tree, and which looks something like this. See here, this HTML part will convert into this structure. Now just try to understand why I am using this and how this is helpful for me. Just look at the example. At the top I have a document, I have HTML. See, I have two sections in my HTML page, one is head and one is body. So think that if I want to go to my body section, okay, and if I am using a something like this, okay, and I don't have a tree, for example, just forgot that we have a tree, and I want to go from my top to bottom, okay, and I am looking for maybe the row. That is the second row, and I am trying to look the data where is a supernatural is written over there. Okay, now what is the procedure if I will try to locate this one supernatural? I will start from HTML, then head, then title, then head, then body, then table. Okay, but do you think it's a good approach? I don't think it's a good approach. Why? Because I was trying to look my content. I was not looking something in the header section. See here, I was trying to look something over here, okay, over here, and there was no need for me to look something. I will come to HTML, then head, and then title, and then text. No, there was no need, okay. So how can I navigate from one place to another in a faster way? I have a tree, and wherever I want to jump, for example, I want to go to this place, this TD, at this place over here, and I am using a DOM. So what I will do is, I will say HTML, and then body, and then table, then TR, and then I will come directly to this place. So this is use of the DOM. And remember one thing, whenever I am saying HTML DOM, we always use one term that is called a node. Okay, so something is written over here regarding the nodes over here. You can just have a look. jQuery methods enables you to easily traverse the HTML document object model and select the different elements to manipulate them, and then DOM represents the logical structure of HTML document, and it describes the way through which document is accessed and manipulated. Just now I give one example that if I want to move from one place to another place, maybe in any node inside my HTML this HTML page, so I will try to locate that, okay, using the help of DOM. Now when it says the document is the main object here, so I will say document node, element is the element node, attribute node, text node, and the comment node. Everything inside this in HTML DOM is treated as a DOM. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, actually, I'm not able to see your screen. Actually, it's
stuck. Is it okay now or not?
No, sir. So your slide is stuck in 28 of 28.
Okay, okay. I will help. I will ask for help. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. Now, okay, yeah, sir. Yeah, it's. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So what I was saying that whenever I create a HTML document internally, it change into a tree so that we can easily traverse from one node to another node. So this HTML page will convert into a tree structure which will looks like this one. Okay, and as I said, that if I want to move somewhere, so if I am looking for the text which is written over here, I will not go this place. Okay, I will not go this place. I will directly come to my table and then I will go to the TR and then I can directly access that node. Okay, so it is just to make the distance short. Now when I try to use this, I have options. How can I, using HTML DOM, how can I traverse from one node to another? I have some functions, jQuery functions which I use, and the examples are given over here. I have ancestors functions, descendant functions, sibling functions, and a filtering function. Okay. So we will move one by one here. Ancestors, okay, means I'm talking about parents, okay, when I'm saying a parent, it means to say if I'm talking about immediate parents, okay, immediate parents, for example, let's say I have one element whose name is UL, okay, UL, so it meaning to say is Dib is the parent of UL, and if I am saying parents, if I am saying parents, it meaning to say is, if I am saying UL is my child element, and then I have a div element, but div element is also inside of div, so when I am asking to access the parents, so it means it will give me the all elements which are the parents of a UL, like div tag, body tag, HTML tag, all that. Okay, so I will display one example to you. So here is my example traversing DOM, and only one program I have over here, and I will try to run it first. Look at the example here. What I am trying to do is I am trying to use the parent, and I am trying to use a parent. I want to use these both functions, and look at this place. This is the node now. What is the starting element? The starting element is HTML. Okay, and inside the HTML I have a head, and head is closed, and then body, I have body. So it meaning to say is when I am trying to create one tag which is inside span. Okay. So span is one tag which is the innermost in this HTML DOM. Now this span's parent is li, and li parent is ul, and ul parent is div tag, and this div tag parent is this div tag, and this div tag parent is body tag, and the body parent tag is HTML tag. So if I try to run this, okay, and in my HTML coding, what I'm trying to write over here, I said span dot parent. Sorry, parent first. I said span dot parent. So who parent span here? Parent is li. Okay, and what I'm writing is direct parent. So just giving a message over here. So span dot parent, and this is some CSS properties I'm setting over here. Now you can see the web page over here. Span, okay. Span is coming here, and who is the parent of span? Li. So it sets the color red color. Okay. Then after, I am also adding one more line. I said ul, and ul over here I am saying parents. It meaning to say is I am talking all parents from here upwards. Okay, so I have a ul, and then the parent is div, then body, then HTML. So what is the style I give? Style I give is color is green, and the border, a dotted border, and the color is orange. So just have a look over here now. UL tag, I was talking about the parents of a UL. So parents of UL, I have a div, then I have another div, then I have over here body, and then at the end I have a HTML. So it meaning to say is when I'm saying parents, it means I'm talking about all parents of that element. Then I have another option here. This example I already explained. I have a parent. Okay. In this example, I was using one class whose name was PORTJ, and this was given in the HTML code, which is given in this file. Then I have another type of function, that is descendants, and in descendants I have a children, and I have a function whose name is find. Now when I use a children method, it is used to retrieve all the direct children of the selected element. It meaning to say is what it will work like the parents. Okay, because you can see it is used to retrieve all the directs. So parent, it was giving me the all upwards elements, and the children will give me the onwards. Okay, then I have a find function. This is how I can use. There is a class named class 1, and I'm trying to find children, and another function I have is find. Okay, so simple, I'm saying ul dot find. It meaning to say is inside the ul, you can see inside the ul I'm trying to find out li. It means all li. Okay, so you can see it's written here is used to retrieve all the descendants elements of the selected elements. So if I have one ul and then I have a li, so it will select all the li elements inside the ul. Then I have another type of function is siblings. Okay, siblings is just like you. Let's say for example me, I have maybe elder sister, or maybe I have a younger sister or a brother. So it will do what? Whenever I use a sibling, it will give me all the elements which are coming in that parent element. Okay, So why we use a sibling, it is written over here. It is used to retrieve all the sibling elements of the selected element. For example, I have one div tag, and in that div tag I use maybe one h1, maybe I use a p tag, and I use a h3. So all three are inside the div. So when I use a sibling, it will give me all three. Okay, I have a next and I have a previous. It is used to get the next element and a previous element. I have filtering functions. I have first function, last function, equal function, and a filter function. Okay, all these functions I will give you the examples in my activity and in my exercise. Okay, first element, it is used to get the first element. The last element, it is used to get the last element. Equal, now you can see here is equal. It is used to retrieve an element at the specific index number of a selected element. It means I am trying to find the element with my index. And the last one is the filter. It is used to specify a condition to select a element. I will give the condition, and it will help me to filter the element according to the condition. I will give the demo of my activity now. In this activity, this is food hub activity here, and what I am trying to do is I am trying to access the node, okay, first node and the last node and all other nodes. In the previous lessons activity, you will also find some other examples. So I'm coming to this activity. This is lesson number 6, 7. So look at the activity over here now. Actually, this is one web page whose name is Price List, and in this exercise, what I am trying to do is, over here, I am trying to make one table here, and I am trying to access the elements, nodes, using the functions. So this is table. You can find, can see my computer? No? So I hope you can see now. I am using a food hub website, and in that website I have created one web page, and in that web page I want to display my web page over here, something like this, and the content is written in my table, and using HTML DOM I will change the color of my first row and the last row and the items which are coming in between the first and last. So this is what I was saying. I have created one table over here, and in this table I have written the content, and I am trying to access this in my JavaScript file. So this is my JavaScript file. You can find over here, I am writing dot content div, and what is this? I need to find here. This is the name of the class. So over here I'm saying dot content div, and now the function name is each. So what I'm trying to do is I said each because I want to give, maybe I want to implement the style to my each row. So I'm saying here dot content div dot each, and then I'm using a function index and element, okay, the two parameters I passed over here. Then I said element dot css. It meaning to say is inside this content dot div, okay, inside this I want to access the elements, and I want to apply the style to those elements, and I said dot css. So it will do what? It will set the background color to my each and every row in this this table. And but I'm not trying to access here with the table. I'm trying to access it with the dot content div. This is the name of the class. Then in the second case over here, again I said content div, and I use the function is first. So what I'm trying to do is I am trying to look the first node, okay, first node, and first node here inside the content div. Now if you will look the HTML part, this is the this is my first node, okay, and it is coming inside this table. So what it will do is it will change the background color. Similarly, I want to change the background color of my last node. So I'm saying content div dot last. So in my web page, when I will run this, the color of my first node and the last is different. And for each row, you can see over here, mean the each node, the format of my font and maybe and the background color is a different. So this is one example how I use these functions, each function and first and a last. Anyone have a question regarding this? I will explain one another example over here. Give me a second, I will find the example here. Not this, yes, this example. So in this example, I just create one box, and in this box, I have tried to use each and every function which I explained in my traversing DOM topic. Here you can see in my this JavaScript file, just have a look. In that I explained one function, it was find a parent children, okay, so I'm trying to use those functions here now. Here in my HTML file you will find that I have one ID named a container of a div element. So when I use a div ID container in my JavaScript file, I said hash container dot CSS. It means I set the background color of my div element using my ID selector. Then I am trying to find the, just see here, I am trying to find the element in which I have the defined one G parent ID selector, okay. So it meaning to say is in this place I am trying to find a div element and whose ID is what? G parent. So here you can see G parent. I am trying to find a ID selector basically. So you can find over here, this is div and then find hash G parent. I am trying to find a G parent ID inside the div element. So here it is, this when he will find this, so he will apply the style. In this example I am not trying to find the ID selector, I am trying to find the element. So over here div dot find ul, then you can see over here this is a ul. I am trying to find this, and when it find this one, so he will give the color to this one, okay. Similarly I am also using one more option, this place I am using a parent. It means I am saying whoever is a parent of the span tag, this is the span tag, and I said use the span tag and find his parent and then apply this color. So in my HTML file, if I will see my span tag, this span tag have a parent whose name is li, so it will apply the style to li. Then after I want to apply style to my span tag, so I'm writing this line, and I also want to find the children of span tag, so I'm saying span dot children, and who's the children of span tag is h6, so it will apply the style to h6 element. So this is the simple example of traversing. Basically what is the use, you just need to understand what is the use of all these things which I am doing. Because sometimes whenever my website is very big and for me it's very hard to to navigate from one place to another place, because it will take time to find when I want to find a element, okay. So it will start from the top and then it will go to the bottom. So better, why not use a HTML DOM, and using the HTML DOM I can directly traverse to my node, okay. So these are the functions which are handy at that time whenever my web pages are very big in size and I have a situation to manipulate the HTML elements, I will use HTML DOM, okay. One more example I will give here. In that example I will use a filter, one more function which I explained to you, that was a filter. So before I start to explain this example, you just try to understand. I'm giving one simple example of a jQuery how to use event. This I will explain it later, maybe tomorrow. But I use one element function, and that was a filter. If you remember a few minutes ago I just explained one element to you, that was a filter, selector. So I am saying span dot filter, it meaning to say is I want to filter a something, and I want to filter what, maybe the class dot focus, okay. So basically this example is for the next topic, how we deal with the events, but still I want to explain it, just show you here. Look at this place. When I am at this place, in my textbook, and if I move to another element, you can see at the same time, one time it is getting a focus and second time it is losing a focus, and one pop-up is coming and that pop-up is gradually getting fade. Okay, so see here, this example I will explain it tomorrow when I will explain the topic of events. Okay, so I will use a filter function. In this case, this is the filter function I use. Okay, so I will stop this session this time now. The next session will start tomorrow morning, and that session is regarding jQuery events. And one very interesting thing, how we use Ajax using a jQuery. Okay, if you have any doubts regarding this topic or a previous topic, I have 10-15 minutes and we can clear our doubts. And I also want the attendance of each and everyone. Yes, please. Any doubts, any questions? See, in this whole course, the first lesson and second lesson is easy to understand. Okay. And then I have a lesson number 6. And 7 easy to understand, and then okay, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 is easy to understand, but a little bit complicated also. So these two lessons are easy to understand, just traversing DOM and how to use HTML events. If you have questions, please raise your questions so that we can quickly solve the problems, and then we will wind up. Hello. Hello.
Yes, Sukhit.
Yes. What's the question?
Sukhit. I'm literally confused with jQuery and DOM, because I'm not able to generalize it. How it has to be used in this particular way.
See, HTML, you just know the concept of HTML, right? HTML is one another thing.
Yeah, HTML
and jQuery is one another thing. Okay, what I was doing earlier when I was not using a jQuery, okay, at that time what I was using is I was just using HTML and I was using a CSS. Okay, and what I was doing, that if I have an HTML element, by using the CSS properties, I was trying to manipulate my HTML element. Okay. Now, after that, what I did is jQuery. I start to use a jQuery. When I start to use jQuery helps me to manipulate HTML elements. Okay. And for that, jQuery provides me different selectors. Yes, jQuery provides me different selectors. Like we use jQuery selectors functions, and we use elements and we use attribute. Okay, so jQuery methods are helping me to manipulate the HTML elements, but the problem arises at that time when I have a number of elements. You know, my web page is very big, and maybe I want to manipulate my HTML elements. But if I try to use a jQuery, so it will take time to find that element. You know, do you understand what I mean? Because it is basically whenever we create an HTML, at the back side it create a tree. Yes. So when you getting my meaning? whenever I'm making any HTML page, in the behind, you know where my system do is processed, so it change it into a tree. So why it change into tree? So that maybe at some time I want to jump from one place to another place. It mean to say is maybe I want to jump directly to one node to another node. Okay. So if I don't have the option of DOM, then what will I do? I will start reading from the top and I will go to bottom. And it is basically a time consuming concept. Okay. It will take a time. So what we do is we take a help of HTML DOM, and HTML DOM help me to directly traverse from one place to another. Means I will ignore some elements and I can directly reach to that element so that I can manipulate that. You getting the meaning?
Yeah. So if I want to traverse from escape some things and I want to go to the next, then that time I can use HTML DOM. Right?
Yeah. I have functions. Yes, we can use a function of jQuery and then by using that those functions I can move from one place to another place. Like I give the examples to you just now. I gave the example. You can see on the screen once again. See, I have these functions like a parent, child, find, filter. All these are functions which help me to traverse from one node to another node. Okay, basically these functions, remember, these functions are the jQuery's function, okay? Functions are the jQuery functions.
Okay.
It's very simple, see? When I am writing this line, okay, and then I'm using this jQuery always, you know, whenever I start to write the coding of jQuery, it always start with a dollar symbol. And it always have a starting and ending, like we create a function, start function and end function. So don't get confused this thing. Just think that this is the jQuery. By using the jQuery, I am just traversing from my HTML node, from one node to another node.
Okay.
Any other person?
No questions. Thanks.
I gave one request to you in the morning also that yesterday I gave one request that please send me your work, create one responsive web page and then send it to my email ID. I just got one person assignment, and I request you all that please create one responsive web page and send it to me. Okay. You understand my meaning? Everyone, please send one responsive web page to me. Just create, okay, and then send it to me by today's evening, okay? Yes. So I will wind up for today and see you tomorrow morning, okay?